I'm Wiebe Professor for Responsible Research and Innovation in the Center for Digital Life in Norway. And on behalf of the Center, it is a pleasure and honor for me to introduce Wiebe Bijker to you. He's here to give the third Volterra Lecture in our Volterra Lecture series in the Center for Digital Life. This lecture series is named after the Honorable Vito Volterra, one of the first mathematical biologists. These lectures are to be given by internationally renowned authorities that are esteemed for their contributions to the life sciences and/or technology development. And as the Center of Digital Life Norway is committed to societal benefits and responsible research and innovation, we are very grateful that we would like to follow our invitation today. Professor Wiebe Bijker was trained as an engineer in applied physics and holds a PhD in sociology and history of technology from the University of Twente. Wiebe Bijker is one of the founders of the new sociology of technology and the most significant contributor to the field of science and technology studies internationally. He has coded two very influential books in the field of science and technology studies, one on the social construction of technological systems, and the other on shaping technology building society. Both of these works are very widely cited internationally. Bijker was president of the Society for the Social Studies of Science and the recipient of its prestigious Bruno Prize. His most recent coded book is Vulnerability in Technological Cultures, New Directions in Research and Governance, published in 2013. Bijker is currently professor of technology and society at the University of Maastricht and professor two at the Department of Interdisciplinary Studies of Culture at the University. Thank you.
Thank you, Heidrun. And you can hear me?
You don't want me to put that on my head.
Absolutely. RRI, Responsible Research and Innovation. Why would you bother? Why are you here? Isn't it an insult suggesting that we researchers have been irresponsible until now, that we need something like responsible research and innovation as a program? Is this just another addition to that zeitgeist that asks everyone to account of all the activities that she is doing, general practitioners spending more time on their computer than having an interview with the patient, teachers filling in all sorts of forms rather than teaching, not to talk about us as researchers? And maybe if we just sit quiet, it will blow over. So maybe a little bit of window dressing, wait, and the next hype will come and we try to survive that one. No, I don't think so. I am going to argue today that RRI is part of a much more general trend in society and that it is here to stay. Moreover, it's not just that. I am also going to argue that it actually makes sense in a general way. And thirdly, that more towards our research, and I mean our literally research in the sciences, the life sciences, but also in the social sciences and in the humanities, that it actually can be turned into an asset rather than something that makes our lives more difficult. There's a little bit of a difficulty that there are moments where I will suggest that actually RRI activities are things that we have been doing, though under a different label. But that's not quite the story. I will also argue that RRI is new and is asking for new steps and new strategies and new ways of working. So that fourth bullet is a bit of a balancing act. We can draw on experiences that we have, but we also really have to figure out how to do this now for the first time. The bottom line is that I will argue that you really need a substantive and integrated collaboration between social scientists and humanities scholars and scientists. I'm going to argue that it won't do to have science and then, as a kind of an afterthought,
say, with brandy and cigars next to the fire in the hütte, some ethical discussions. Now, from the beginning, you need to integrate, I'm going to argue, for a proper ROI, the substantive contribution of the scientists and the humanity philosophers and historians and the social scientists. I'll do that in five steps. Four examples. First, the nanotechnology risk governance in the Netherlands. Then a kind of an interlude, taking a step backward and saying something about the field of STS, Science, Technology and Society Studies, where I'm coming from. Then again, three examples from the Netherlands. First, a huge life sciences initiative in 2009. Then a big societal dialogue on nanotechnologies. And finally, something that actually only was completed last week, a two-year process of formulating a Dutch research agenda. And through that, and weave through those examples, six different slides that will summarize different elements of RRI. So they will come through the presentation. And I'm really happy to share the slides afterwards that you sent me or either an email. Okay, first example. So this was about risk management of nanotechnologies in the Netherlands. But what I really want to talk about is the process of the advisory committee that formulated that advice to the government and what happened behind the scenes of that committee. The task it was given was to advise the government on the risks and benefits of nanotechnologies. Both the risks and the benefits were in the mission of the committee, and we were asked, it was a really open question. It was 2005, more than half of the members of parliament had never heard of nanotechnology, so it was a sort of forward-looking measure of the government to actually ask a committee to think about this. The composition, and that is where my story will turn around, the composition was four nanoscientists, then one philosopher, one social scientist, that was me, and a secretary, a PhD, a toxicologist, very highly trained secretary, who would do most of the writing. The outcome, before I tell you a little bit of the story behind the scenes of that committee, the outcome was that yes, there are promises, but also quite serious risks. So the committee didn't result in a kind of promoting story about paradise being at the horizon behind the nanotechnology developments. No, it quite clearly said there are risks too. We even did a kind of a page counting, so that even at face value, you wouldn't be able to make up your mind as a reader if you would just look at the table of content, that there would be four chapters on benefits and only one chapter at the end on risks. No, we made sure that the risks and the benefits were, even in that trivial way of counting pages, were kind of balanced in the report. And we argued for a new style of risk governance. Now, behind the scenes, you can imagine, well, at least I could imagine, that those four nanoscientists were a bit nervous. They wondered what that philosopher and that social scientist, was the chair of the committee, what to make of that? What were they going to do? Very obviously and self-proclaimed, they did hardly know anything about nanoscience. So what the hell were they going to do in that committee? That relatively quickly changed in two steps. The first step was when it became clear after about two meetings that the philosopher and the social scientists were there not to make this into a kind of a fighting committee, fighting about the merits of science or the merits of nanoscience. That was not at stake. But that already put you almost saw physically the scientists relax a bit and sit back. It really changed when the outcome came in sight, when halfway the committee process, we collectively, as a group of seven, we started to work towards the outcome of that committee advice, which I will explain in more detail in the next slide, but I will first finish the story about what happened in the social process behind the scenes of the committee. It was quite a relief for the scientists to see that their scientific uncertainties were taken seriously. Too often they had been in a position, and maybe not personally, but say as a persona, as part of a collective consciousness of scientists, had too often been accused of some of the problems that science was causing in society, while feeling that, well, we have warned for the risks. We did argue that there are certain risks involved in nuclear power stations. So don't blame us when things go wrong. Here was a very explicit acknowledgement of those scientific uncertainties. There was a recognition that there is a limit to scientific knowledge. And it's important to realize that the effect of that was more relief than feeling accused. That our limits to scientific knowledge is something that every scientist knows. I mean, it starts from the very first freshman's year in college that you learn that. It's the outsiders who think that science knows everything, and that creates the trouble. So recognizing the limits of scientific knowledge really, really helped. And then finally, that new governance scheme that I will explain in this slide. What the committee argued was, let's not just throw all the risks on one big heap. Let's realize that there are very different risks associated to scientific and technological development. And these are the three types of risks. There are known risks, there are uncertain risks, and ambiguous risks. The known risks, don't be mistaken. You can still die of asbestos or radioactive radiation. But those are examples of the known risks because everything is known about it. Scientific knowledge is complete. You understand. Scientists understand asbestos, they understand radioactive ionizing radiation, and based on that knowledge, they can design protective measures, regulations, and standards. So we argue, in such a case, if there's a problem, you only need a committee or some process in which scientists are involved. You as society have paid for their training, you pay for their salaries. If they don't do a good job, you fire them. There's no point in having other people there. We're not going to have a vote whether 2 + 2 = 4. No, this is their business. They are trained to do it. Only scientists need it if there is some risk involved in that known risks box. That is different in the middle box. That is different in, for example, nanotoxicity issues. In the case of nanotechnology, there is scientific evidence that nanoparticles, small nanoparticles, are toxic, are highly toxic, but it's not completely understood yet. The example is gold or silver. Even a secondary school child knows on the basis of or chemistry, that gold is an inert material. It doesn't chemically react to other materials. That's why we wear jewelry. It doesn't affect our skin. But if gold is made smaller and smaller and smaller into nano-sized particles, it suddenly turns highly toxic. Now that is something, there is scientific evidence. This is not technophobia. There's scientific evidence, but it's not completely understood. Now, what to do in such a case? What to do with these developments of nano drug delivery systems? Very clever delivery systems, nanobots that bring the chemotherapy exactly to your tumor without doing damage to the rest of your body. Wouldn't it be great to have something like that? Yes, let's go for that nanotechnology development. Or no, are the nanotoxicity risks of small particles too large to run that risk? That is a problem that the scientists very honestly say, don't ask us. we don't fully understand that. We have put it on the agenda, we explain there is a risk but that we don't yet fully understand it. So it would be unfair to completely load the decision what to do with nanodrug delivery systems on us. Now in that case you need the involved stakeholders, in this case patients, oncologists, maybe life insurance companies, and then together with the scientists, and knowing that there is no full scientific knowledge, then the decision should be taken also weighing the stakes in favor of fighting tumors or in favor of not running those unknown, yet unknown risks. So, have scientists plus specific relevant for that issue stakeholders at the table. The third category is yet of a very different type. Here, in the middle category, at least we all agree in society that we don't want toxic materials in our world. There's no discussion about the direction in which the world is to move in this context. That is different in the case of ambiguous risks. Again, an example from nanotechnology. My favorite example is a brain implant, a nano chip into my brain to upgrade my memory. My wife has a very large family, and all those uncles and aunts are very difficult to sort of navigate by in birthday parties or increasingly funerals. And I would love a memory chip, but you can imagine that the other half of the world thinks that that is the last thing that we should do, tinker with God's creation and the identity, the autonomy of the human body. That is a kind of a discussion that goes to what fundamental values about the direction in which we want to develop our society. So the stakes are unclear. The stakes will depend on the values that you see for society. So there's no escape that in such a case, in addition to stakeholders, you also need to invite citizens who really should participate in discussion about the direction of society. Now, this was the basic scheme that the committee presented to the government. The Dutch government basically accepted all of this, and I'll return to what they did with it in a particular case later in the lecture. At the end of this first example, I want to draw out a few elements of RRI. This is RRI avant la lettre. When this happened in 2005, RRI as an acronym and as a program in Horizon 2020 or in the Norwegian Research Council didn't exist. So I'm kind of twisting the words, but I do think that I can draw examples. For those four dimensions, some of you will have seen these before. These are four key dimensions of RRI, and I am, in the next slides that come, I'm going to highlight some elements to each of those, in this case only to two of them, of those dimensions. In the case that I just discussed, very clearly there was a reflexivity process going on. Very clearly those scientists started to think in a different way because of the discussions with the philosopher and the social scientist about their practice as doing science. The codes of conduct are a standard element under reflexivity, and the committee didn't result in a code of conduct immediately, but it did feed into the European code of conduct for nanoscience process 1 or 2 years later. It quite directly fed into that. So code of conduct, as an example of the reflexivity dimension of RRI, it really can be illustrated in this committee process. Responsiveness, not responsibility, this is something different. Responsiveness as a proper way of reacting to what is happening and responding to that and adapting behavior, funding, strategies. In this case, examples would be alternative IPR regimes, alternative regimes for intellectual property right. I have elaborated that you can imagine that something around that would emerge if you have discussions like the ones that I showed in the previous slide. And that similarly might lead to new rules and regulations, new standardization. Second example. Oh, sorry, this is not the example. This is the step back and a brief interlude about what STS is, what science, technology, and society is. But this is the briefest summary that I can give. I think in STS, roughly two types of questions are being asked. The one is, how is scientific knowledge made? An example are anthropological studies in laboratories or in clinics. And the other big set of questions is, what role does science and technology play? And questions about the governance of risks of emerging sciences and technologies, the one that I just talked about, is an example of that. If you look at it in a disciplinary way, you will find sociologists, philosophers, historians, anthropologists, increasingly now also economists, organizational scientists, who apply their skills and their theories to science and technology. The core message of STS, I think, can be summarized. I would like to summarize that in 3 points. The first is, development of knowledge and innovation is not a simple linear development. So the picture that first you have fundamental research, then you have applied science, that turns into technology, and then you bring it to society, it just not works like that. It is empirically wrong. Secondly, there is a spectrum of knowledge. It's not just layperson's knowledge versus scientific knowledge. And then under scientific knowledge, I would also label humanities and social sciences knowledge. No, I think that STS empirical research with theoretical research has shown that really there is a whole spectrum where, for example, patients have a very distinct type of knowledge about their own illness. But you can't label that scientific knowledge, but it is knowledge that increasingly is valued by also medical doctors and that they realize should be taken into account. So it's a different kind of expertise and knowledge, but not necessarily less, depending on the kind of measuring rock that you apply. And thirdly, science, technology, and society are completely intertwined. I summarize that by the statement, we live in a technological culture. And if I say that, there are two hidden messages. One message on the left is to my colleagues, well, let's put it like in Trondheim terms, the colleagues in Dragval. Don't think that you can understand current society if you do not also take into account the role of science and technology. And the other side of the screen is the mirror image of that message, the message to scientists and engineers. Don't think that you can build a working technological system or develop a proper scientific understanding of the world if you not also think about how that is embedded in society. For me, this one slide with the message to the social sciences and the humanities and the message to the scientists sums up, say, some 30 years of work in STS. Okay, that was a primer on STS. Now back to the examples, back to the Dutch example. This is an example, between the inverted commas is the title of the report, which is in English. The reference is at the end of the presentation, so if you ask the slides, you can also find the reference. It's called Partners in the Polder, a vision for the life sciences in the Netherlands and the role of public-private partnerships. This happened in 2009. It was a huge endeavor, so industry, almost all universities, and university groups that did something on the life sciences participated in that, funded by the government, and they pulled together a huge kind of research program for the life sciences. As the title shows, there was a strong emphasis on public-private partnerships. It was elaborated around the full breadth of biotechnology, so the green biotechnology on agriculture and food, the red on medicine and life sciences, and the white on energy and industry. And that's why I'm bringing up this example. There was an explicit attention to the role that social, well, here is called social aspects of biotechnology. would mean. And this slide sums up what the report says about that. The report argues that research into social aspects of life sciences is indispensable for a strong life sciences sector. So it explicitly said, hey guys, let's forget to do this. Let's forget to build this strong biotechnology and life sciences endeavor in the Netherlands if we do not also include an explicit attention to the social aspects. The next step in the argument was, so that was already then, point two is already elaborated how to do that. The report argues that organized interactions, and then they give examples, with and between, so with science, with those stakeholders, but also between those stakeholders, so really it becomes a kind of a round table picture, in civil society are necessary for a democratic, and thereby, so that link I think is important, a democratic and thereby sustainable development of the life sciences and the technologies. It states here quite explicitly that if from the beginning that life sciences project would not think about how to link it to a democratic development of society, that in the long run it would not be sustainable. And then finally, it argued for specific new forms of good governance, particularly of the social issues surrounding life sciences. And then it mentions brokering, and that is the one that I want to highlight on this sort of harvesting slide at the bottom. One element in responsiveness in RRI is to develop brokering skills. In the Netherlands we have brokers who help you sell and buy houses. And it is borrowing from that metaphor that also the metaphor here is used. So a broker, a knowledge broker, helps to link a source of knowledge to a place where that knowledge has to land and has to be used. But not in a simple way of taking it up and dropping it. Then it would be something as simple as communication or distribution. Now the idea of knowledge brokering is really to take both sides, both parties seriously, and to have a two-way communication. So to feed the need for certain types of knowledge back to the laboratory and the place where the knowledge is produced, and try to really broker the relation between the two. That is one form of responding to the call for RRI that very clearly comes from this effort of pinpointing the social aspects in the report that I just cited. At the top of this slide is another example of anticipation. Anticipation is one of the dimensions of RRI that says RRI asks us, scholarly scientific community, to think ahead, not just solve the puzzles that our scientific tradition suggests, but really think ahead about what is needed in society. So identify grand social challenges, like is now explicitly is being done in Horizon 2020. And in different National Research Council exercises that is also happening. I'll give another example in the Netherlands at the very end. So shouldn't we wait? Should we wait another 5 years or 10 years? Then we know what we're talking about. If you wait 5-10 years, then investments will have gone so far that even if you then think, okay, well, better not do this, or turn left or right. It may be too difficult to change the course because of all the investments in equipment, in institutions, in people. So no, let's not wait for 10 years. Okay, let's do it now then. But we don't know what we're talking about. So that dilemma, which is called the Collingridge dilemma, after David Collingridge, who first identified it in the late 1970s, that Collingridge dilemma was also faced by the Dutch government. But in this case, they decided to bite the bullet and do it now. So they thought, they said, well, yes, we will know much more in another 10 years, but we think it's too risky, and we've learned our lesson in the genetic modification debate, and we've learned our lessons in the nuclear energy debate. Let's now not wait until it is too late. Let's have a discussion now and somehow try to solve that problem that the citizens hardly know that nanotechnology exists, let alone what the aspects of it are. Okay, that we did. In a 3-year process, 2009 to 2011, it was just before the economic crisis, we were allowed to spend 4 million euros on it. And I'll skip all the details. There is a reference in the last slide with an article that describes some of those details. I'll just give you the outcome. We checked, I was vice chair of the committee, that's why I'm saying we. I was vice chair of the committee who organized that social dialogue. We had a survey measuring the knowledge and the opinions and the evaluations that the Dutch citizenry made of nanosciences and technologies before the dialogue and after the dialogue. And we compared both measurements. And what I'm now going to say is based on those two measurements. First, there was an increased knowledge and understanding about and of nanotechnology, and that includes the benefits. If you understand what nanotechnology is, it has been taught you through giving examples, and typically those examples are things that are nice and work. So there was a small but a statistically significant increase in understanding of nanotechnology. Second, there was also a better recognition of the risks involved. So there was, a small but statistically significant increase in understanding that this is not paradise. It's not all simple and positive. There actually are more risks than we realized there are. But thirdly, there was more support for nanotechnology amongst the general citizenry in the Netherlands. But with quite explicit quotes like the one that I put on the board, as long as you cite, and I remember seeing that pricking finger of a woman saying, as long as you scientists keep on paying as much attention to studying the risks as you pay on developing the nanotechnologies. But basically, at the end of that 2-year process, and through a whole range of involving thousands, 10,000s of people in the Netherlands, and a whole range of activities from science cafes to a commercial TV, children novels, art installations, through that whole process, citizens generally had the feel that scientists were sincere, really tried their best to understand the risks, really tried to move society forward by developing nano technologies. And on balance, they realized that as long as there is that balanced attention to the benefits and the risks, they were willing to take the risk and let's move ahead. My conclusion about democracy is that citizens are not afraid of science and technology. No, if they're anything, they're afraid for anything, it is about an industry and a government that doesn't tell them everything. My conclusion is that if you take them seriously enough, citizens can understand difficult dilemmas, can even understand difficult technical issues. It's worth getting them into there, and then they can make a relatively balanced. But if you take them out, if you don't involve them, then they may get, and quite rightly so, they may get suspicious, and they may lose in a much broader sense faith in science and technology. Now, elements that I want to highlight here is, under the dimension of anticipation, the importance of recognizing, in addition to hard impacts is something like something being toxic, also soft impacts. Soft impacts are impacts on, say, dominant values, social relations. Those elements can, on the long run, can have a much bigger impact on society than the hard impact. So it's important to realize that both kinds of impacts play a role. In that debate, we used a whole variety a whole variety of means of helping people to grasp knowledge ontology and to discuss about it, including the arts, literary forms, filming, theater, pedagogy. And I think you need such a broad range of activities if you take seriously the engagement of such a broad range of people. You can't put everyone just behind the text or in a lecture hall. For some people, you need very different forms of communication. And under the dimension of inclusion, in this case, we included a broad range of expertise. Again, as I mentioned in the SDS slide, ranging from artists to scientists and union leaders with a specific perspective on labor and the risks that labor that laborers have when they work with nanoparticles in paint factories, for example. And we used a broad range of technology assessment methods. Final example. And it just finished last week. The Dutch National Science Agenda happened, which is quite interesting, at the request of the government. I don't think that any of us scientists would have had this idea. Actually, it took us by surprise. We also felt that since they are asking for it, we better do it, because this all happened 2 years ago. This may be a chance to actually get the government to listen to us, science community. We're not quite sure what they mean by asking this, but let's grab the opportunity, ask for a budget, and promise that we'll do it. That became an adventure in which the secretariat, I have only the biggest admiration for that secretariat that managed it, almost from week to week had invented that whole process. Which of course made some other people complain, because the rules of the game kept changing too, but that's what happens if you try to so quickly adapt to an opportunity that is there. This was led, those are the people who grabbed the opportunity, by a complete coalition, and with complete I mean without fighting, of there is only one National Research Council in the Netherlands, the Royal Academy of Arts and Sciences, all of the universities plus the polytechnics, and industry, the large R&D led industry, and some skeptics who say, well, the result of that national agenda is completely worthless and it's just paper and the government will not listen. Even they agree that the collaboration of this knowledge coalition by itself is a big step forward, because most of us were fighting each other constantly, and that really stopped when we had a response to that national agenda. This was the process, a six-step process in 2 years. All Dutch were asked to send in questions to science. Individual citizens, labor unions, industry, faculties in the universities, you name it, everyone and anyone could send in a question. That resulted in almost 12,000 questions to science. I'm now in step two. Those needed to be, well, the word was, I'm not quite sure that that's really the best word, but we used the word validated. Meaning that certain questions were taken out. There were certain questions that just could be answered immediately. People didn't know that, but you could answer it immediately. There were other questions that were decided, which is a little bit more tricky, but were decided not to be scientific questions. I mean, my favorite example, I don't think it was really sent in, but we used it in explaining to people what to do. My favorite example is, is there a life after death, and can you make a profit from it? Well, that is a question that we ruled out. So there was a process in which a scientist of the Royal Academy went through those 12,000 questions and condensed it a little bit. Actually, a little bit. I don't know, to some 7 or 8,000 questions. The third step were three very big national conferences. that were designed to cluster those 8,000 questions in some meaningful way. That resulted in 140 clusters. Those clusters were then, and that was mostly done by the secretariat, were then kind of written out and giving some flesh on the skeleton and giving some sort of internal argument. And then finally, and that happened in the last half year, we elaborated, we being really a lot of scientists around the Netherlands plus various stakeholders from industry and NGOs, we elaborated 12 interdisciplinary routes, a route in with two meanings of that metaphor. It was a route through the 140 questions, so one route connects a subset of the questions in the research agenda, and secondly, it was also a route towards a certain goal for society. So it showed the way how, by addressing certain scientific questions, the Netherlands could move to a particular goal at the horizon. And that resulted last week in handing over an investment agenda to the government, asking for €1 billion extra per year. The important thing for today is that it was specified that half of that extra money should go to the, say, the RRI topics of the national agenda, and half of it should go in an unqualified way to fundamental research. So I'm highlighting that because I want to counter the fear that RRI research would be the end of fundamental research. There's nothing internally in that logic that asks for it. You can make an argument for RRI and still argue that you need basic fundamental research in order to have a sort of a base for RRI. Mm-hmm. Why is this relevant? Because it shows that societal questions can be translated into an interesting research agenda. And that was the big experiment. Can we just ask anyone and somehow make that societal question into a research agenda? Engagement of citizens and stakeholders does work. That I'd like to conclude from that exercise. And then the point that I just made, that there is more support for science among citizen organizations as a result of this national agenda. People being involved, being excited. What I didn't mention is that actually some of the research organizations, the universities and something like the Meteorological Institute, invited people who had asked certain questions to come for a whole Saturday, and they would explain them the research that was related to the question that they had asked. So citizens actually got a new relation to research and science through this exercise. There is more collaboration between university and non-university organizations, and my final point about fundamental research. I'm going to wrap up. Last slide. What is RRI? The penalty. This is the quote that you will, I'm not going to read it, this is the quote that you will find, the definition of RRI, if you go to the European Union website for Horizon 2020. This is what Horizon 2020 says that RRI is. It's a long quote. They thought a lot about it, they negotiated no doubt a lot about it. The briefer summary is that RRI is taking care of the future through collective stewardship of both science and innovation in the present. So it is really thinking about the long-term future of our societies, but by now thinking hard about what science and technology can contribute. I'm not going to present this slide, but that is there if you really look at it on your own screen. This sums up all the elements that are part of the four dimensions. And I want to return to the title of the talk. My title was RRI will make your research, our research, research in general, better. Well, I still have to argue for that, I realize. So what is better? Well, most of us, or maybe I should say most of our administrators, our deans, say, well, yeah, there is peer review, but then we do a lot of counting. We count your publications, we count your patents, we measure, calculate your H index, and often that's where it stops. That is the answer to what is good science. Good science is being peer reviewed, high on publications, how high on patents, and high on the H factor. What I'm arguing is that we should also think about incorporating elements like this in the answer to what is good science. And I think this is nothing revolutionary. I think that most scientists that I know still think about it like this. They don't do it for the count of the publications. They do it because they think their work is of importance for society. Most of them don't check except in birthday parties, but they at least they are motivated by doing something that would resonate with what citizens might be interested in, that would lead to innovation, not in a narrow sense of getting a patent and getting a bit more money, no, innovation that helps to address big problems in society. And like the ones that were defined by the United Nations and all countries in the world in terms of social development goals. I think that most scientists are actually motivated by such things and maybe even will feel frustrated that they are not recognized for that motivation and that contribution to the world by only looking at the top four blue criteria. So that is what I mean, that RLI will help you make your research better, because it is a vehicle that more explicitly draws in issues as here are on the bottom. I think RRI has golden opportunities. It has golden opportunities for digital life Norway. The first white is straight from the proposal of digital life Norway, and it's too small, even too small for me to read, but it is, I mean, that is what DLN has committed itself to, so I don't need to argue for it. You have to do it because you're paid for it. But let's think a little bit further. I think that because of this, I don't know of any big project, nationwide project, like this one in Europe. It does provide a kind of an RRI laboratory for Norway. So I think that Norway would benefit by checking how RRI works out in this case of DLN, and can benefit for very different fields and different disciplines. And I think that from the base of DLN, and particularly the RRI character of DLN, that creates a very strong base for applying to Horizon 2020 program. Horizon 2020 is investing hugely in RRI. RRI is really being mainstreamed through a broad range of research programs in Horizon 2020. And if you can show that you have that you have the skills and the institutional infrastructure to deal with that, then you're an extremely attractive partner to partners all over Europe. I also think that RRI is a golden opportunity for NTNU, for the university. I think that this is the first time that I'm in this campus, but I know the various campuses from bus line 5, and I know about the plans for a merger. I also know about this master student who studied the merger of 1996 and still finds some of the divides that then existed and that still exist. So my argument would be that if you take RRI seriously and if you really take it as an opportunity to do something different, then maybe even that merger that is going to happen here at these campuses is going to be a little bit more than just putting, buildings next to each other, and I'm still hoping for a cable way between Leuven and there, but otherwise just trying to escape the traffic on the big road in between. No, if you take RRI seriously, you may get to something that substantively is something new because of working more closely together in those various disciplines, in those campuses. So in conclusion, I think that ROI will only work if those three kinds of scholars, scientists, social scientists, humanities, will work together. But I do think they need to work substantively and in an integrated way. It's, as I said, it's not enough to just ask the ethicists to paint a little bit of pink on a scientific project. It needs to be at the core of the research. I think that occasionally the social scientists and the scientists should write together an article, because that is where it really the insights are being hammered out. But if you do that, then I think it can be extremely exciting and helpful. Thank you.
Thank you, I really enjoyed the lecture. I was hoping, can you go back to your slide where you have the divide and the kind of symmetry? Picture there. Because I was wondering a little bit about the claim you made there, because I, as kind of, as somebody trained in STS, yes, here, I was thinking that there's a kind of asymmetry here, so that, and maybe that I would think that one cannot hope to understand science actually and technologies without understanding the role of technologies. So that the claim was not, it was a bit heavier, not just about applying science and technologies in society, but actually understanding science and technology. So I was curious about that, whether it was intentional or not. And on the reverse, we might say, you know, like one cannot hope to understand society without understanding the role of science and technology, but maybe there's also some pragmatic aims that we are fulfilling, I don't know, through these types of collaborations. So yeah, I thought it was a really nice slide, so I wanted to kind of give you.
I think I completely, did
yeah.
Anyone hear the question? Do I have to repeat it? No? No, I think I agree with you.
Yeah.
The cheap excuse, it's cheap, but it's still true, is that I had to figure the words so that they would fit the name.
Yes.
So the fact that I used understanding in both sides is not because I don't think that the intervention, the engagement, the building the world isn't part of actually on both sides. So I think that, and in a way, some of the examples that I've given are examples of that, that STS is not only about understanding the world, it's also about engaging with the world. I don't know whether that works in Norwegian, but in Dutch we would say in getting dirty hands. It is forgetting the footnotes and going out and trying to do something. When I engage in that national dialogue, I had to forget about the footnotes. Some of my colleagues were critical of what we were doing. So it is not about it's not only about understanding, it's also about intervening. That is what you were pointing at.
Yes, and not only about intervening, but also understanding.
So
the lower part, it was intervening missing, and on the upper part, I thought maybe the understanding was not so, not understanding the role of society, but also understanding the technologies themselves.
I would like to have both, on both sides, both understanding and intervening.
Thanks.
RRI always seems to be a hard towards science and technology and life sciences, but you also use it in relation to social science and humanities. For instance, study RRI and the economics discipline or financial markets, so
I think so. I think you're right that at this moment most policymakers and people in research councils wouldn't think of that. But I hope that gradually we can sort of nudge them to make them see that. One of I'm currently doing a project. Just as a researcher, I applied for research council money, and we do a project on biogas in India, together with a chemical firm. But we end up not only looking at that particular enzyme that the chemical firm developed, but we end up looking at what is sustainable agriculture for farmers in Punjab. What are markets actually? So that it goes directly to Europe. So we are actually now asking, what is a market for these farmers? It's definitely not what people stand to think it is. How does we draw in the role of women? Because they're not part of the normal picture if you start talking about biogas. But if you draw in food and the role that food plays in the family, and then you do. So we are drawing in, with the excuse of RRI, you're drawing in questions that maybe the original policymaker didn't have in mind. But I think I don't think that anyone would objectively do this. But if this happens for a while, and if more RRI projects do things like this, then I hope there will be a project that will argue for an RRI sort of mainly economics agenda, but involving scientists. I don't know enough about that field, but I can imagine that you then would bring in information scientists who are clever about digital models. I wouldn't want it like an exclusive social science event. I would want the scientists to have a proper role in such projects too. But you're right. We are not. I mean, that is still to come. I don't see any principal reason not to go for it.
Thanks for a very interesting lecture. You said sort of as a bind on something about the shortcomings of traditional democracy agenda can sort of help us reinvent democracy, as you put it.
In the standard picture, or the world for which our current democracies were invented was a world where science and technology only started to play a role, but not in a kind of permeated, all sort of intertwined way that it currently does. So indeed, and I think until 1970s, I think most of our countries were happy by having incorporating science and technology through hearings. Scientific expertise, advice through Office of Technology Assessment or the Royal Academy giving advice. But I think the scientific and technical problems of society, and not only the problems, but also the possible solutions, are so everywhere that packaging them in a separate hearing for Parliament doesn't do anymore. I think that the big problem of nanotechnology that we had really was helped by that broad societal dialogue. Many more people now realize what kind of choices are sort of in front of us. But it didn't really fit the standard picture of democracy. I mean, so that democracy is figuring out what to do with such consensus conferences and dialogue. That's what I mean with, I don't have a ready-made answer, but I do think that we need experiments like that, and then figure out ways of feeding that into the existing process of democracy. And RRI is an example, in the sense that in my biogas project, we do intervene in those farming communities in Punjab. And we do talk to the state level and even the federal level people who design sustainable energy policies, But we try to make them see that, that things work out in the village differently than they think. So in that sense, the biogas project is directly sort of, I wouldn't say experimenting with democracy, but intervening in a quite conscious way in the democratic processes that are at work in India. I don't mean that in a critical sense. I don't mean that things are wrong and that we're going to show how to do it better. But the RRI element in that project makes us explicate and put on the agenda issues like that, in addition to, say, the chemistry of the biogas production or the... So that's what I mean. In that sense, it is a direct, there's a direct connection from RRI to such big questions. But I'm not saying that I have any answer. But I want them on the agenda, and I think that we can contribute to that.
I would like myself with a question because I see that mostly people from the democratic countries are raising questions here. So I'm trying to put myself in the position of the speculator, which kind of questions maybe people from the democratic countries maybe might want to have. And I see that I really appreciate your talk, and you showed how RI really started a big change in encompassing changes in science governance. You talked about policy discussions, and you showed how the entire research again of the Netherlands is written in a completely different way, and I think this is fascinating, and I think it will also spread to other countries. But what does it now, what does it mean for example scientists in biotechnology, nanotechnology in Norway when they're sitting and they're writing their research proposals and they're facing demands for integrating RI in their individual research process? So you, for example, say you have this slide with the known risk, the unknown risk, and the biggest risk. Would you also here, for example, recommend that there might be some research projects who don't need such a strong role of RI in the researchers? So would you recommend this for any project? Or another question is, there are many researchers who already they have existing equipment, existing research groups. Maybe they go on from this so-called consultant that make note that we had in April said, yes, I want to do something different.
I think the only, honest answer that I have is get a social scientist on board, because what I've tried to argue is that there is something. Something substantively different happens when you sit together, the three of you, on a particular, a piece of equipment or a research question. And I don't want to fall into the trap of now sort of easily and with a sort of loose hand give suggestions to your question. I think that would undercut my argument to really take seriously the collaboration between those three people. Let me give one example. The philosopher, the social scientist, and the scientist. So the bottom line argument to Heidegger's question is get the social scientist into your laboratory, and then see what happens. The past 3 years I've been working. That's a very different. A very different example, but I'll make it into an example for this question. I was asked to work with researchers in the Netherlands who do clinical trials on malaria. And what they do is, I'm not going to tell you the details, but the core element is that they infect healthy Dutch students with malaria. And then see whether they fall ill, and then cure them in time. And even those medical researchers, when they told over coffee in a conference what they were doing, they saw that even their colleagues in the medical science ability that, are you infecting Dutch citizens with malaria? So they slowly realized that they actually were doing something quite exceptional in the sense. Not in the sense that they didn't go through all the loops of ethical review and all that, and peer review, and they have had papers in Nature and in the Lancet. So no question there, but they realized that they have set up a machinery of clinical trials that is actually quite exceptional. So they asked me to join, and we worked together for some 3 years to understand what was happening there. Not in terms of their narrow, not in terms of their usual medical research style, but just let's take a step back and what is happening in this machinery? And that resulted in a very different kind of understanding of how the clinical trial works that we published in the end in an SDS journal. Until the very end, we were still not sure whether we would submit it to a clinical trial journal or to an SDS journal. In the end, we submitted it to an SDS journal because we figured that, well, I figured they couldn't decide that, that it actually was giving insight more generally to how science works. But this happened when they drew in a social scientist into that clinical trial laboratory. No one could have predicted this. So my bottom line advice is don't be afraid and get together. And it's a high risk business, but isn't that always high risk? So I would say sit together and see what happens. Of course, you also have to write your paragraphs and that's a skill. And I think we will all develop that skill. But the real work happens when you sit together and then something, I think then something quite new may happen.
Thank you very much for me. I have a very positive experience as well, like including social science people into the project. But I think this is a very, very fruitful collaboration going on in the project, which I'm a part of. And so I totally agree that including social scientists, philosophers, maybe artists in the process of developing a project proposal is definitely something which is relevant. What I'm a little bit concerned about is that if you say you want to have the three persons involved in the project, wouldn't that mean that there would only be 1/3 of the financing for the science itself? How do we balance exactly this issue? So I think what Ivan also mentioned is there may be relevance for including the social scientists and the philosopher in certain types of projects more relevant than in other projects where it's actually quite obvious that the social science, like a societal challenge, is addressed in a clear way. So it's pretty clear that this is within what responsible research and innovation should be.
I think I will quickly agree that I'm not arguing that everything should become paradigm. I already applauded the outcome of the national agenda that says 50% should be fundamental research and we won't say anything about it. That's completely leave it to the scientists. So I think that's good. But back to the first half of your question about the Dutch, I think in the Dutch Research Council in its RRI program specifies that there needs to be a social scientist and a scientist and a humanities person on the project, and they define a minimum for all three, and you have to budget for it. And I like that. When I had to fill in that application, I hated it because it is yet another trick where you have to combine things and make everything fit, which is already difficult, and this adds an extra layer of complexity. But it did push applicants to really think about how and also where in the work packages you need that input, and proposals, and there were proposals that did it only with two of the three. They were just not declared not admissible. Whether that means equal amounts of money to all three, that